You gotta handle the rock with flair and rhythm if you want to be judged on wood grain and concrete courts in New York. This ain't no nickel and dime. It's Dribble N Dimes, where scoring never looked this good, I guarantee it. But was your reputation built from the playground up? Or did you call next and they took that ish? All cause you weren't as fast as police and ambulance sirens? Or as loud as Mr. Softy Ice Cream? No. You see, this is New York City hoops in prime time. As beautiful as the skyline, it's Dribble N Dimes.
He arrived to the South Bronx not knowing the English language. He frequently walked past crack-infested blocks to attend Rice High School. Through hard work and determination, he learned the language and dominated the basketball landscape. He racked up every basketball award within reach, all while repping hard for his beloved Dominican Republic. In his senior season, he led the Rice Raiders to the city and state chips and took home the 1994 Gatorade National High School Basketball Player of the Year Award. He went on to attend St. John's University and played several seasons in the NBA. We're honored to chop it up with New York City legend Felipe Lopez on this episode of Dribble N Dimes.
Yo, welcome to another episode of Dribble N Dimes.
Yes.
I'm Manny Digital.
This is Emilio the Poet.
And with us today we have... Dale loco.
¿Quién eres tú? ¿Cómo que te, tú cómo te llamas?
Oh, inglés o en español.
¿Cómo, ¿cómo te quieres, papá? ¿Es tu boca? ¿Es tu boca?
¿Qué es lo que, hermanito? Estamos de este lado, de lo mío. Tú vas a saber quién es ahorita. Tú vas a saber quién es.
Should I say it?
Yo, I meant to say, yo, he was on the cover of the 1994 Sports Illustrated.
Yes, he was.
Looking like the Dominican version of Michael Jordan.
That's right.
St. John's University.
Yes.
Wait, before that.
Number 13.
Rice alum.
Rice High School. Rest in peace to Rice. Unfortunately, they're not here no more. But
yeah, but he's repping.
But yeah, man, it's the one and only Felipe Lopez.
Felipe! De lo mío!
Yo,
before... A ver, mi gente, what it is, man. Que lo que, mi gente. Estamos contentos. You know, we happy to be here.
We happy.
Yes.
Happy.
We happy.
No, we definitely happy to be here, man. And I'm honored to just be sharing this opportunity with you guys. Listen to the program. You know, you guys doing an awesome job, man. You know, anytime that any Dominican is doing something, I always stand up and proudly, you know what I'm saying, support it. So that's
thank
the reason.
You.
I took myself out of the house in this snowing, beautiful day.
Yes!
And we're making it. We're making it happen.
Yo, that's actually a great point because it was a mission to get here.
Mm-hmm.
It was also a mission to get started to record. And Felipe has been nothing but gracious and patient with us.
Yes.
Of course, I gave him a little beer.
Yes, he's
so...
only...
Presidente.
Aunque me mandaba por el carajo a few times already. He said I'm a desastre. But that's okay. Who's counting?
Well, you know what's the thing about it? Like, I'm pretty much unused to it, but, you know, as Dominican that we are, we usually have a different kind of standard when
right.
it comes down to a scheduling thing.
That's terrible.
So somebody told me 5:30, it's 7 o'clock. I'm still fixing things over here.
Yo, his time is super advanced, let me tell
yo,
you.
Yo, he's Dominican, though.
¿Ese reloj de está?
No.
Señores, we're going to have to start pre-o. Oh, yeah. Where's the clock around? Take
people don't even understand. Like, there's a clock behind us that it's been saying 6 o'clock for the past hour.
Yeah.
It hasn't moved. It's just waiting for Emilio to get here so it can start, you know, like, rolling.
Siente feliz estar
yo. No, yo. Happy campus, Dominicanos.
Yes, yes.
Yo, so Felipe, I mean, first I want to give a shout out to Jamie Peterson. He was our third guest on the show, and he was the one that connected us with you.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, big up to the big dog Jaime.
And that was a great interview, by the way. I listened to the whole thing.
Yo, thank you.
I was able to discover, you know, different things about Jaime. I always love Jaime. That's my big brother.
That's what's up.
You know, I always looked up to Jaime's, you know, from the time that, you know, he played at Pittsburgh, but. You know, some of the struggle that he went through, I never knew about it.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, for people to actually just hear his story, you'll be able to just be amazed on how much of these wonderful human beings have, you know, come from the bottom and made the best out of any kind of situation. So
that's right.
You know, we're fighters, and I believe that everyone has a chance to make themselves, you know, proud who they are through hard work, endurance, persistence. And that's why, you know, just listening to the story, I know he always been successful with everything he's done.
Yes.
But, you know, the story just completed, you know what I'm saying, that part of Jaime that I never knew about. And I appreciate it much more.
Yeah. Thank you, man. Yeah, thank you. And we're eager to hear your story, man, because I know for myself, I speak for me, but many of us, especially Dominican Americans, I'm a Dominican, we followed you, man. You were our Jordan. You know what I mean? You were, man. Like, you rocked the same
job. Why you say were? Like, he's still here.
So you are Jordan. No, but you know, like, Sports Illustrated te dio una.
Miguelito Jordan.
Miguelito Jordan.
Miguelito Jordan. See, if they would have done it like that back in the days, yeah, I would have been much appreciated. Yeah. I'm like, yeah, Miguelito Jordan. Yeah.
No, ya te bautizamos aquí.
So now that leads me to my first question.
Go.
Do you feel like that was too much pressure too soon for you when that happened, when they put you on Sports Illustrated back in 94 when you was in St. John's?
Well, first of all, I had no idea that I was going to be in the cover.
Okay.
They shot the piece. It was, first of all, so it was a great shot. I'm in the tugboat all the way downtown by the Liberty Park.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just jumping on the trampoline with a basketball and a uniform. So that was as live as it can be. There was no Photoshop. There was none of that. So I really enjoyed the shot. But I basically had no clue that I was going to be in the cover of Sports Illustrated, because that same year that was Ray Allen. They shot Ray Allen. Mm-hmm. They shot Iverson, Kerry Kittles.
Yes.
And you know that was a great
class.
Yeah, that was a great class of incoming, and some, you know, Ray already had, you know, he was already at UConn. So, you know, he talked about the Big East being back, and it was pretty much for the fact that how strong every single team was actually, you know,
predicted to be.
Yeah, because Kerry Kittles, Villanova, you had a lot of
Syracuse. They had Lawrence Morgan.
That's right.
You know, they had.
Damn, I love the Big East.
Wallace, you know.
Yes, John Wallace, New York.
You know, so that was the reason. So I had no clue. And another one, I basically had no idea how the impact of being in Sports Illustrated was back then. I really
had no. You didn't realize how big
big the magazine is,
right? Mm-hmm.
It still is.
Oh, I see.
You know, the fact that I'm still signing. You know, to this day, 20 years later,
really?
I'm still signing covers. I still get people that,
awesome.
You know, when they know that I'm doing like an NBA event, they bring the magazines over to me. I have tons of people send it over to the school so I can sign it and send it back.
That's so cool.
And for the sports related, it was huge. But from the social related, just the image of a Dominican kid, an immigrant coming to the state, I think that was for me. What made me the most proud about that cover, because it was basketball, but then on the flip side, you were able to see another side of what Dominicans are all about and what we are capable of coming into this country.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, socially, not people was able to see it like that, you know, but for me, I was trying to make a stand out of social issues, social, you know, injustice, because when you talked about, you know, Dominican Republic back in the 80s, what's the first thing you think about? We all know.
Balaguer?
Blanco.
That's
big.
You understand what I'm saying? So, you know, that and baseball players.
Right.
Okay. So that was just the only model that we was kind of related to.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, so.
So how did you end up, because I know your dad played semi-pro, I believe, baseball, right? How did you end up going left? And
because my father really wanted me to play baseball. I tried to play baseball. Unfortunately, I felt that it was too rough.
Okay.
Right.
Too rough.
Wait, you thought baseball was
too rough. After you get hit with the baseball twice on your nose. Twice.
By the same pitcher? Was it the same
pitcher? No, it was at two different occasions, which is the funny thing. The first one, I'm in practice. I was playing first base. And a little roll up, third baseman catch it, he throws it. Mm-hmm. So I think the ball is coming high, so it curved. He went from high to low. No. So I went high, the ball went low, boom, right on my
nose. How old are you? What is the age?
13.
Oh, yeah. So right before 12. You came to the U.S.?
Yeah, like I'm like 12, 13, around that age.
Okay.
Man. So, you know, I blacked out, swollen, bleeding nose. And it just so happened that I had to walk back to the house. And on my walk back to the house, my mother used to clean the church.
Okay.
During the afternoon.
In Santiago.
See, in Santiago.
Oh, okay, perfect.
So the church was going on my way to the house. So I stopped by the church to see my mom with my swollen nose.
Right.
And the minute she sees me, she think that I must be wilding out somewhere.
Right.
You know, I'll just, you know,
getting himself
in trouble. Right. And at the same talking, she see me bleeding, she must have got nervous.
Right.
And her first reaction, what you think it was?
Damn, I'm going
why which one?
No, I'm me.
Mijo, yeah, that's a good one. What about you? I went
all the way
out there. Te vamos a dar para Nueva York.
Yeah.
Para Nueva York. I was not traveling yet. I was still in the yard.
Okay.
So anyway.
Oh, so I'm right.
¿Quién fue que te hizo eso? Vamos a matar.
Yeah. That was one of them.
So the one that I said was right, though.
No, you're actually wrong. Well, her first reaction.
Yeah, I went to Felipe Lopez.
Was to slap me.
Oh! Oh, because it was your fault.
Oye, pero la calle.
Claro.
Es una violencia.
No
wonder he made her away. Because
she said, yo, something happened and he's the cause of it.
Yeah, so that's the first reaction. She was like,
pero te llegó that? Did she even? No,
yeah.
You should see.
Oh, okay. You know, mom's got the fast. Let me ask you a question real fast, and I don't want to cut your story off because we still want to hear it. Yeah. How tall is your mother?
Oh, no, she's not.
She's a little lady. Is she a little lady?
Yeah, mom? My mom is. Nah, she barely right now. She's 80 right now, so she's.
You know, wow. Shrinking.
Okay.
So she's like 5'6".
Okay. Okay. Because see, our mom is probably around 5'5"-ish,
but on a good day.
That's the one person of shorter stature that I'm deathly afraid of.
Oh.
And to this day, she has the reflexes. To whoop our ass anymore.
Oh, yeah.
And it was not just myself. I had two brothers and a sister.
Right.
So every time my mom just raised her hand.
It was everybody.
I'm going for the peace, bro.
Like, for real. So somebody's, you know.
Catching it.
Yeah. You're doing the dab. Like,
before that was cool.
Before even happened. To this day. Right. To this day, my mom, like, you know. But she actually, now she regret it. Like, she was like, ay, mi hijo. Yo no sé por qué yo le daba tanto a ustedes. She was a teacher.
Okay.
And she was, you know, by the book.
Right.
And because of her strictness, she was a really good teacher.
Okay.
You know, obviously now, it's not that I'm opposed to, you know, giving a younger kid a regimen to go by. I think I'm all for it and things like that. And obviously, times have changed, but not for everyone. But for our family, it really helped my mother just being strong.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Not just for my mom. To this day, like one of the most amazing thing that I get is the fact that that NBA and stuff like that. But my mother literally helped just raise through her school. So many individuals that when I see them today, the first thing they say, oh man, your mom was your teacher. She helped me how to read.
Wow.
She taught me how to read.
That's beautiful.
She was my first teacher. She taught me how to read and write. And today I'm a doctor.
Wow.
Today I'm a business owner.
Oh my God.
Like to me, like that's something that when you give that kind of power to an individual, I'm just always amazed of how
far she's been able to reach people.
Yeah. Yeah.
That explains your success, man.
It also explains, you know, a lot of the things that I do in the community.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because to me, it's like, it's an extension.
Right.
I want to, her legacy is on her own.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it was just so powerful, just touching people like directly. My legacy in a sense is like just to continue
her work.
And continue to make her feel proud of what, you know, everything that she has done on this earth.
That's beautiful.
With your own, you know, lane.
My own lane and things like that.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Because, you know, she's my biggest supporter. She was always on my game. And I always felt that it was my duty to make sure that when I finished a game that she was happy.
Yeah.
Wow.
That she was proud.
Was that pressure? Did you feel pressure? Or was that
enjoyment.
Just... Okay. So that was like, it was a motivator.
Yeah, it was every enjoyment. Night. For me, it was really enjoyment to see my mom, my brother, the fans that used to go there, con la plata, no la tambora, la bandera, you know what I'm saying? Felipe Mania and everything. So it just really got to a time that for me was enjoyment, like to just see that, to see that support. Because I knew that once I step into the basketball court, I had control of my own kind of, you know, thing. Yeah. Like, right. You know, I have control. Like, I worked hard enough that new one that competed, you know, in a sense, had a chance because, you know, my confidence, I'm not thinking about what I'm going to do next. I just want to do it.
That's it.
I'm just going to try.
Let me tell you something. Our experience, we went to middle school. Our mother used to go to our games. Y lo nervio de ella, mano. I used to have 15 turnovers a game, easy. But I was doing triple double the opposite way. Because
I
mean,
I still
wake up like this.
I know it's you know, I have my son and okay. My son, he's already in college. He played at Christ the King.
Nice.
And,
we gotta look for him.
What school does he go to now?
Huh?
What school does he go to now?
Yeah, University.
Nice.
He's not playing. He's just
academics.
Okay, that'd be.
But you know, with my son, he almost felt like sometimes like an added pressure for him because he felt that he needed to kind of like just
be like that.
I'll do like, you know, just kind of do a little bit extra. Mm-hmm. And a lot of time athletes, if they don't know how to deal with that, mm-hmm. it could be a little bit tough, you know, for them to play because the fact that my mom never screamed at me like, "Oh, mijo,
right,
shoot the ball," stuff like, you know, most parents, you want the best for your parent, right.
For your kids.
Right.
Kids, yeah.
So, you know, they screaming all kind of thing, and the kids, they truly listening.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and they feel that they have to do what's right for you instead of what's right for yourself as a
fan. Team.
Right.
You know, so yeah, I can understand, like, you know, players, first of all, not having the self-confidence to go in again and know that you have control of things and allowing things from the outside to really,
interfere
to, you know, to what you have to do in the basketball court.
Hmm. So I want to get back to the baseball, to the nose.
Yeah,
right? So you stopped off at the church.
And then I got slapped. You. Boof.
Okay.
Like, cool.
What happened?
So that's I'm done with that because
yeah, no kidding. You don't want to live that again.
Yeah. So and then, you know, I retried it. I'm like, you know what? I'm just gonna go back, and this is not gonna be the end for me. First time traveling outside Santiago.
Okay.
I made the travel team for the baseball. For this baseball,
mm-hmm.
And we go to Puerto Plata.
And was that your first time, you personally, traveling outside of Santiago?
No, I already had travel with basketball.
Got it. So you were playing basketball also?
Yeah, I was playing basketball.
Got it.
I always played basketball, so baseball was out.
How old were you when you first started?
Basketball?
Mm-hmm.
Man.
Six, eight?
I built my own baskets.
Oh, shit.
No.
So I would carry my baskets.
No, but I don't
know. You would carry your baskets? So.
Yeah, because it was movable. Like, I could move it and put it like on a... I could put it like on a light post and tie it around the light post, and then there we are.
I would like for you to do me a favor and send us an image. If you have it somewhere. You're going to waste our eye now so we can post it on Instagram.
Can we make one? Can we have a workshop and make one?
We have to do a workshop.
Yeah,
we'll do a Dribble N Dimes workshop.
No, okay. Bro. I think it's easy.
No, it's super easy. You take, first of all, the rims, they're huge. Like, you don't miss.
No, they have confidence.
No, because you take a bicycle, you take the rims.
Oh.
And you take the spokes.
Spokes out.
Yes.
Now you got the holes that you can just nail. You can put the nail right into the spokes, and then go right into any kind of wooden piece. You take any square piece, you attach it to the wheel,
mm-hmm.
And then you have a basket.
Was that common in Santiago? Or were you like everybody was doing that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was the most common because you're not gonna see a regular basketball ring. And then my father used to work mechanics,
mm-hmm.
in DR,
mm-hmm.
So he actually brought me, like, it had something to do with a truck, but it was a really nice, perfect round piece that the engine used.
Okay.
And like there, I was able to weld it to like this metal piece, and now I truly had like a really nice like metal ring.
So Felipe's drunk was the basket of choice.
I have all, I have the kids that like, come over my. So if I was in punishment and I couldn't go, like, okay, punishment, you know, you're in DR, so it's 85 or better every day of the season. So you're not staying inside the house.
Right.
So punishment is that you can be in front of your house, not too far away where, you know, your parents cannot see you. So if I was in punishment, I would just put the ring right in front of the house.
So everybody else
can
be.
So they can just come. But if I was not in punishment, I would just go up to the block, put it out there, and then have, you know, a bunch of kids out there too.
Wow, that's so cool.
So then I built one, and then my other boy, Javetico, he had his own, so he would put his basket on one end, I would put mine the other, and then we have full court.
Yeah.
We know basketball now, we're playing with socks.
Oh, wow.
We're playing like, so you know, you're running and you gotta act like you're dribbling. So you gotta do like the thing like you're
motion,
dribbling.
Right.
If you stop doing it and you dribble again, that's double dribble.
Nice!
Wow. Wait, so imagination is crazy.
Yo, that's hold on.
Wow, yeah.
Yo, I always said that's dope. And I looked at my own family, right? We obviously Dominican, you know, family. I have a ton of cousins. We're a big family. Mm-hmm. My mother's siblings is 9 of them. So I have a lot of cousins. I think every single cousin of mine has a skill that I'm just in love with. And I look at myself and I'm like, yo, I don't do shit, bro.
Yeah, because you have to be creative, bro. Like, we don't have no toys.
That's
man.
It.
You know, it's like every season we have to, like, Chichigua. Kite.
Yeah,
right. Like, Chichigua, we make our own kite.
Wow.
You know, we built our own kite.
Trash bags.
And trash bag, and then you have the little bamboo from the from the coconut trees in Tosavaina.
Yeah.
You tie them up. You know, the tail, you just rip a shirt, and then you tie it together. You know, so we have to be very creative and improvise on a lot of things that a lot of people, like in a sense, like take for granted.
Yeah.
You know, we built our own cars, like racing car, con cajebola.
Yeah.
What's cajebola? How do you call cajebola?
Girl.
I'm not even sure I know what that is.
Yeah, you know what's a cajebola? I'm going to get you with the cajebolas.
Yeah, I don't know. It don't matter, yo. Dribble the dice. We don't.
We're going to have a
Dominican culture.
You know what
section.
We're going to do? We might have to bring you back on the show, but do this.
A workshop. Making Dominicans artifacts.
Yes, that's what's going to be on video. Talk to me about, you know, first of all, as I'm super happy and grateful, I'm going to tell you why. So a lot of times we see people of our own, we get to a higher status, like you were in such a high status.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, in my experience, like with celebrities and stuff, people tend to be like, yeah, they're not relatable. Like,
it's normal for any human being to be at a position, and next thing you know, your standard, you know,
changes.
Right.
Like, you think it changed, but in reality, it's not. It's just that you run into some more money.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You're still the same person. You know, you get different friends, but these friends are a lot different than your boys from back in the days because now you have friends that have money as well.
Mm-hmm.
So they're only going to see you for that status.
Right.
Not for who you were.
Right.
You feel me?
Well,
can be to your boy, you can just be and chill. And if you don't got, you know, if you don't got for the Brugal, for a bottle of Brugal,
you
get 5, I get 2, I will get 3, all right, so we break them off.
Yeah. Right.
But if you don't have it with that other standard, you're front.
Yeah.
You're gonna front it out like, I'm cool, I'm out.
Right.
You feel me?
Did you? So I
went through it. Like, you know, my first paycheck in the NBA. You know, I bought everything that I wanted. It was unreal. You know, I just ran into a whole lot of money. So, you know, bought my mother a home. I bought myself the car that I really wanted. That I always pictured. I had a picture of this Suburban on my room at college. That's what I was kind of aiming for.
Right.
You know, bought myself the home that I wanted. You know, so all those things, it made me feel like I was a little bit, you know, bigger than I was. And I had the gold change and all the other stuff. And then I realized going back to my hood, because I'm from the hood, Santiago, and Sancho Libertad.
Yeah.
Then I'm like, hold on a second, like, I'm fronting on these people. Because like, there I am, you know, with the gold and all the other stuff, you know, shining. Meanwhile, my boys, they're still the same.
Right.
They have the, you know, the broken shoes. They just, you know.
Hard to eat.
Yeah. Right. You know, with the back in the day, the clothing is, you know, so
it's
I'm
regular,
like, you know,
yeah.
I'm shiny. I'm like, so I'm acting like I'm big. And I'm like, you know what? I can't do that. I cannot do that to my people. Like, I can't be
something,
you know,
you're
something
not.
That I'm not. You know what I'm saying? In a sense, because they still hungry. I live here, they're going to be hungry.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So I'm going to come here, I'm going to do this front, now I'm going to leave it, you know? They so I prefer to do that, like just do something for them.
That's beautiful.
And that's always, I mean, once you came into, you know, the pros, that was always something that you continued to do.
Oh, yeah.
I know you do a lot of it now also, but like that happened, that mindset took on quickly.
Yeah,
it wasn't
quick.
Like, okay.
No, it was quick. That's was dope. Like probably my first trip to the Dior.
Okay.
After, you know, I'm bougie.
Yeah. Yeah. Bad and bougie.
Yeah. After that, you know, and you know, that's, I don't do the gold change and, you know, I might, I don't know. I'm from the longer. I own one.
Right.
Two.
That's two more than me.
And then, you know, if I gave myself a change, I go to the yard and I run into one of my younger artist kids. Like, you know, they I have a lot of my kids in the yard. They artists and things like that. So I'm like, yo, here, you rap though. You know what I'm saying? It goes more on you than me. I can cope another one. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. So, that's so cool, man.
So I wait, so 12, 13. You get knocked in the nose a couple times.
So then I go to Puerto Plata,
okay,
right? So
right.
I go out for the first time. And it's my first actually competing game. We're playing against another team because
right.
I'm tired of practicing with my own people. So
right.
The game starts. I'm playing first baseman again. There's a little pop-up in between the pitcher and first.
Correct.
Everybody in the mama is going for the pop-up because you want to catch it. Doesn't
right.
matter. You're not calling for no, you know, you just want to catch it or you want to be part of the game. So I'm going for the ball. The pitcher's going for the ball. We're not seeing each other. Here he goes. Boom. Hit me right on my nose.
Again. Damn.
Oh, my God. But it's not
wait, that's the
yeah.
second time?
Yeah, that's why my nose is, you know, I usually had the Michael Jackson nose. Not the old school Michael. But, you know what I'm saying?
The newer.
So then I went from the newer to the old Michael Jackson. So I was the opposite.
Yeah, but you were famous como sea, como sea. You were going to be famous.
So and the funny thing about it, like this time, it really knocked me out. Like I was out cold.
Uh-huh.
So when I got up, I was unconscious.
Oh,
I was under a mango tree.
They just dragged you to a mango tree?
Mango tree just laid me down.
Oh, no, what kind of mango you said? Yeah. So,
para matar, man.
No.
Para matar, man. And I got up, and it's like ninth inning. Like the game was over.
Oh, shit.
So and after I went back to Santiago, I was like,
I'm done.
No more baseball.
I'm done. And that was my last baseball experience.
That was your first and last real game.
It was, yeah. And then after that,
Well, thank you to all those circumstances.
Yes, because it made you into a great basketball talent. Let me ask you, you said you were playing already in teams, travel teams for basketball.
So I have two brothers and a sister. I'm the youngest.
Okay.
So I grew up just being the rebounder for my brothers and my sister.
Okay.
Anytime they have practice, I'm there.
Right.
At a young age. So,
they've been playing ball too.
They're a lot older than me.
Okay.
So, you know, so in a sense, I was attracted to basketball because of them.
Okay.
My brother
okay.
and my sister.
Okay.
You
okay.
see, so just the fact that I would just like be around them and everything, it just helped me, it attracted me like right into, you know, the game and just, you know, practicing and passing the basketball and all that. And I would just wait for my turn. To kind of like shoot around, you know, whenever I came. So they really pretty much just got me into the game.
Okay.
You
that's
know,
awesome.
So the good thing is that in DR, just like here, they have like different league, mini Benjamin, mini basket, intermedia, infantil, juvenil, which is start from a mini Benjamin, it start with 10 and under.
Okay.
So you can play on that league. And then from 10 to 12, you have mini basket. From 12 to 14, you got intermedia.
Mm.
So I started playing at the mini Benjamin, the youngest kid.
Okay.
And my first experience, I was playing with all the kids and, you know, the club that I'm the president right now. I'm the actual president of the club in DR.
That's dope.
And it helped me, you know, just to be into a team kind of, you know, atmosphere. Once I got to like 10 years old, after 10, I started, you know, my game started kind of developing a little bit more. I tried it out for the regional, to make the regional, el equipo La Selección de Santiago.
Okay.
So they selected 12 kids for all the Santiago area to represent Santiago, to play against the capital, Santo Domingo, Puerto Plata, you know, Montecristi, all those. And I was fortunate enough to make that team.
That's awesome.
And it was incredible because, you know, the story to make that team was to me, something that motivated me to never stop. Because
so that experience was kind of the fuel.
Yeah, that the fuel it. To get into a level that, like, after I hit that level, I never stopped. So there's like 45 kids trying out because it's all, you know, everybody for all the different clubs in Santiago, and we have plenty of clubs.
Right.
And I'm one of them representing my club. So the coach that is running the practice, he forgot his whistle at home.
Okay.
So he just told everyone, okay, just start running around the basket, just run. So he leaves, he gets into a motorcycle, motocito que tenía. He gets into a motorcycle and he leaves. So the minute he leaves and all the other players see that he's not there, you know, some guy just started, you know, walking, you know what I'm saying? Some guy would run and they stop. You know, they were just like not really taking it serious because he wasn't there.
Right.
So I'm not following nobody. I'm not following you that stop. I'm following that. The coach just say, run.
Run.
So I'm just staying running. You know, I'm passing people. I'm just running, right? And he finally come back. And when he comes back, he gathered the whole team around, 45 kids. And then it just so happened that he had somebody watching. So he called the kid that he's been watching from outside. He's like, you come here. Like, who stopped? And the kid was like, he stopped. He was like, all right, whoever stopped, you out of the team.
Wow.
So he went from 45 to 25. Players.
Wow.
No, man.
So from the 25, I made that cut, and ever since then, I represented Santiago on my 12 and under 2 years, and then 13 and under the year before I came, I represented Santiago on like the highest level of basketball to go to, you know, play against other districts.
Yo, I'm so happy to hear that, man. That is such a freaking beautiful story.
What?
I shake your hand, but I know that's your mom right there instilling that kind of like.
Yeah, right? It was like, yeah.
So that was gonna be my question. Like, why wouldn't you? I mean, you're how old? 13?
At that age, I'm 11.
11.
Wow.
An 11-year-old kid, me? Normally, if the figure is gone, that's normal. They're gonna stop.
Because the thing was, like, I like basketball was a passion, man. And then when you really want to go somewhere, it doesn't matter. Like, somebody can tell you whatever. If you believe that's your passion, you're going to do whatever you have to do in order for you to accomplish those goals. You know, and there I am in a land and a territory that I was unknown because I wanted to be known.
Right.
I was not on the team. Mm-hmm. You know, so, you know, it's a competition where you have to go against somebody else in order for you to gain that spot. You know, you have to earn it.
Yeah.
Right.
You know, so I never saw myself as like following such and such because you're doing whatever because I have my own goals of what I wanted to do.
Right.
So, but by that age, you already had goals and aspirations for basketball?
Like, yeah,
you
already my goals like were not like, oh, I'm going to play. No, my goals were like, I want to make this team.
I want to be the man of Santiago.
No.
Not even.
No, I was just not the team the that you were. Yeah, I just want to be on this team.
Because you knew how hard and difficult it was to be on that team.
Exactly. And I never had that experience. And so that was an opportunity. So for me, it was just like, just give me an opportunity, and then I would do the rest, in a sense.
Okay.
You know? It worked for me in Santiago when I got there, when I made that team. And it was, for me, it was a great experience because I have the experience to play for my club, which it was cool. But because I was an elite 11-year-old that I was already, you know, the best player on my club.
Yeah.
But then I was part of a bigger team, which was the national kids.
Got it.
Wow.
So it helped me to like travel the country a little bit more, experience play at a little different higher level than just playing for your club.
Right.
And I'm playing against other guys that were better. I was not the best. I was probably like the seventh or eighth man on that team.
Okay. Wow.
Oh, on that team.
Yeah. But even though you were elite, you were part of the eight elite?
I was part of the 12th elite.
Oh.
Because the team was 12.
And you were like seventh.
And everybody
was seventh. I was the seventh, eighth, ninth man.
Wow.
You know?
Who was number one? Do we know
on
that?
That? Yeah. No, like a lot of the kids, you know, they Santiago guys, you know, some of them might have played in like a semi-pro in DR.
Yeah.
You know.
Centro Basket, maybe?
Well, actually, Santos. Santos Ceballos. He played with the national team. Okay. And we actually played together.
Oh, okay. When you played with Jaime.
When I played with Jaime.
Antigua as well?
Exactly.
Nice.
So, you know, he was one of the kids that played in Santiago at that age. And then we actually made it all the way to the top to be on the national team. You know, I don't go out.
Right.
But I would tell, if I go out, I goes out. I don't go out just to, be people watching. No. A mí me gusta bailar típico, merengue, toda la vaina. So I'm the one in the dance floor, like, you know, especially if it's a típico.
Yeah.
So when I go out, I go out. When I go do an event, when I go out do events, I go and do my events. Because I will feel like this is going to be the one and only the beginning impression of who I am with you.
Yeah.
So I gotta come out here. I gotta do the thing right. You know, we're not gonna do it halfway. We gotta stay here for whatever time we stay here, and then we get it done.
De lo mio.
I appreciate you saying that, even though it was all about me. Coño. Coñazo. Did I say coño?
Wait. Speak
up. No, I appreciate that. I don't take that no way. You right to say what you're saying. Can I just ask that? I'm gonna ask that Olympic question real quick though.
Go.
Because, so I had a off-air conversation with Jaime Peterson about the Olympic team, which I didn't follow because I was too young at that time when you were on the team.
Mm-hmm.
But I learned about it later, and I started watching, recently.
YouTube and whatnot.
And started. But my question to you is, do you feel, because you have a good range from 80s to now, do you feel y'all was the best Dominican national team?
No.
Cause he said yes. That's why I'm asking.
Jaime said yes.
Jaime Peterson.
No, we were in the best team.
Who do you think?
Who was the best team that you know of?
Well, okay, so in recent years, I participated with the national team. The one and only time that I participated, it was not through the national team. They didn't ask me. It was Orlando Antigua that asked me come and work with us.
Oh.
So Orlando, just being my guy, my mentor, he kind of got me into the national team because they had never asked me for my service.
Oh.
You know what I'm saying?
Is it because they didn't know about you or they weren't working?
Nah, they knew about
it. But why wouldn't they?
It just, you know,
politics and bullshit.
It is, exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh,
so anyway, so the best team was when Al Harford, Charlie Villanueva, Francisco Garcia, Luis Flores.
That was recent.
Yeah.
Yeah, it wasn't too long.
So you're saying that team would have beat your team?
Come on, man. You got three NBAs, and then you got, like, you understand what I'm saying?
Edgar was no joke.
Edgar, like, you understand? They got John Michael Martinez, which John Michael Martinez
had. The center. He was an athlete. Yeah. I remember him.
He still play?
No, not anymore.
Yeah,
but I remember. They had that squad.
He had heart, though. He played with heart.
Yeah, so they had
heart.
That squad.
I remember
so,
that.
So, yeah, like, we honestly, we can say that Jaime can say that we had a pretty good team. Everybody in your own era, you always going to think we were the best.
Yeah.
And I can just say, like, yeah, we had a pretty
bomb squad.
We had a bomb, yeah. But that squad that I'm talking about, they certified G's. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
Like, all of them, they certified G's, you know? And you can, you know, you can multiply that however you want, but, you know, these guys, they a lot stronger, a lot smarter. They play at a higher level than a lot of the, as a whole.
Right, I get it.
As a whole.
Of course.
You know, so that's what I would say, that, you know, they were the better team.
That's fair.
That they basically did not accomplish the thing that, you know, that we should have.
Right.
That goes from the top.
Right.
I see.
You see what I'm saying? So now that goes on top. Which we always have a problem from the top.
Yeah.
Always.
They don't know how to
administer,
you know,
and
exactly.
You know what though? I want to say, man, because,
and I believe that we eventually we have a team that will make it to the Olympic, like Puerto Rico and Cuba and some of those countries, because we have the better talent. We just haven't had the best organization. When you have players like myself, Jaime, Orlando. I would not say Harford right now. We have so many elements to be able to come in as formers, national players.
Now I play NBA.
I play NBA. I play in Europe. I play in Venezuela. I play in Mexico. That you can bring all those ingredients together to help, you know, shape, you know, what's supposed to be done.
Yeah.
And you don't use them, is because you're either ignorant, you playing too much of political cards,
yeah.
or you just not seeing the whole picture.
Yeah. Right.
Because what you're seeing is how much I can ingrain myself, how much can I make myself, you know,
bigger.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? It's not about the collective, you know, happiness that this group can bring. Mm-hmm. It's just about, oh, nah, I was the one that put this together. It doesn't really matter. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah, it's sad, but you're right. You're absolutely right.
It's sad because I, as a, you know, someone that represented the Dominican Republic from the heart, to this day, I have nothing against, because the country doesn't have anything against any individual.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? But the people sometimes do things that are not for the will of, of the country.
Yeah.
Right. You see what I'm saying?
It's about self.
So when I represented the Dominican Republic at a young age, not just in college, but as a national player.
Yeah.
I was the last player to actually lead in points in a pre-Olympic tournament, 1990-something, in Argentina.
Wow.
The last player to, you know, have the highest average over in the whole tournament.
Yeah.
Wow.
And here I am, the national team comes, the Dominican national team comes to the U.S., and the U.S. national team asked me to work with them. And I'm here standing with a USA shirt.
No.
Wow.
You know, watching, you know what I'm saying, watching the Dominican team. And,
on the other
side.
You know,
I'm like, yeah. So I'm like.
How did that make you feel?
Sad.
Yeah, of course.
It made me feel like.
They don't appreciate.
It made me feel like shit.
Yeah.
Because they don't appreciate you the way you know you deserve to be appreciated.
But not even that. Someone else is appreciating you.
Exactly. That's the thing about it. It's just like that someone else is able to see on you something that your own people are not even, they're not even, because they too caught up into it.
Yeah.
But you know what? One thing I want to say, man, I'm appreciative of is from just meeting you and Jaime Peterson, you guys are very much about community, at least just speaking to both of you. And I think that speaks well for future generation, like you were saying.
Mm-hmm.
Because before, see, because my thing is, and I'm saying it from the United States standpoint, because we were born here.
Mm-hmm.
I have this thought now. People talk about Trump and all this and the presidency. And the, at the end of the day, you can affect your community to the best you can, right?
Of course.
No matter of the president. So, but you guys are that example. Because you guys do that. My brother does that too. He does a lot of things with a lot. He has a lot of people that he's
I sit on some boards.
He's affiliated with so many that I don't even have. We gotta have to. That's another list of people.
Don't worry about that. It's not about you.
No, but that's not the point. The point is that there's hope with people like you. Mm-hmm. Because they didn't do it, but you're doing it, and then you have a collective of people mm-hmm. that can affect the youth coming up.
Oh, yeah.
So that's a beautiful thing.
I have not stopped doing what I'm supposed to for my end.
Right.
Just because I don't participate in any activity with the Dominican national team at the highest level. I do run my own nonprofit in Santo Domingo, which, you know, to this day, we have been able to help youth, you know, not just navigate to the basketball
and
education, but also help them travel to this country.
Wow.
You know, like try to the visa and that kind of
scholarships, you know, with different
teams. That's so cool.
You know, and sending things over there. You know, like I mentioned, I'm the president of the club.
What's the name? Can you tell us the name of the club?
It's GUG, Gregorio Urbano Gilbert.
Okay.
En el Barrio Libertad, el Barrio, Barrio Leña.
Okay.
So it's a club that was founded in 1974, the same year I was born.
Mm-hmm.
And it have been giving, you know, so many opportunity and dreams to the youth in our community. So I was going through a process that I was running my nonprofit, and because everything is turned political in the DR.
Right.
So when it comes down political, it's not doesn't necessarily go for the benefit of the people.
That's right.
It goes into, okay, we're going to do this thing right, yeah, for this moment. Then when it's non-political time, then it's dead. There's nothing that can be done.
Right.
And then you have a figure that doesn't understand about sports running a club with no activity for no youth. So now crime
is high.
It's higher. Now you get, you know what I'm saying, a lot of kids on the street. The club is closed instead of being open to the kids just to be able to, because that's what I did. I used to go out to the club just to, you know, just to.
Right, just to hang out.
Just to hang out.
Right.
You know, and then, you know, one of the things was that it used to be a playground, open playground.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you go out to any playground here, everything is open into the air.
Yeah.
Right? So when I made it to the NBA, I had a meeting with the president at the time, So the president asked me, like, you know, what would you like? What would you like the country to do for you? So one of the things that I asked was, I would like an indoor on my club. I would like, you know what I'm saying, instead of being, you know, playground, I want to make sure that it's an indoor kind of facility. Nice. And they built it. They built the indoor, you know what I'm saying, with different hallways, different things that you can throw a party. We have now, you know, through my presidency, I've been able to renew the judo club, karate, chess, art.
Wow.
You know, in basketball, in all the other things, in volleyball.
Right.
So now we have more activities on. The kids are more involved. Wow. They're busy. They're doing different things that they're supposed to do as a kid.
As a kid.
That's you know what I'm saying? Right. So that's my motivation for me. It's just giving it someone, just go and do something. Because you never know.
Something productive.
Yeah, for sure. You never know. For sure. You know, you're using your time wisely. You're out of the street. And at the end of the day, you don't know how that is going to be able to impact your life at a later time. Or create the opportunity that you might just be looking for.
That's right.
That is so awesome, man. That is so... I'm telling you, man.
Yo, I almost feel bad going back to your own story. Like, that right there.
No, man. I want to go into your story. But that is... There's nothing more important than what you're doing outside of basketball. And that's the beauty of it. I'm proud, man. I'm seriously proud.
It's crazy that we're talking about it. I'm like, basketball, we can talk about basketball all you guys want.
Yeah.
To me, like, it wasn't about basketball.
Right.
It's about what I'm doing right now. It's about, you know, using that time, the basketball, to be able to build, you know, the things that I'm really comfortable, enjoy doing right now.
Yeah.
Well, I think basketball gave you the opportunity to have the platform.
But I never allowed basketball to use me. I use basketball like the way it's supposed to.
Exactly.
You know, I graduated from college, you know.
That's awesome.
And, you know, I'm able to keep the job that I've been doing for the last 10 years with the NBA as an NBA Kids Ambassador.
That's
you know,
awesome.
That's huge.
So when they were so many other great NBA legends, mm-hmm. you know, I was able to use what I was given and introduce it to, you know what I'm saying, to this part of the world where it have given me the opportunity to continue to be, you know, reveling and giving back and enjoying the things that I truly enjoyed doing.
Yeah.
Yo, that is...
So I want to go back. You mentioned earlier that you don't typically go outside of your house. You're homebody, but when you do go out, you go hard.
I was hard.
Right.
No, but we're going to have to put some typical on for you.
I saw you on your, I'm patrolling you on Instagram. I saw you with Zoe Saldana
the other day. Love her.
And I saw y'all had a very warm, embracing, like, real hug.
Yeah, I love her.
¿Cómo se dice?
¿La mordiste o no la mordiste?
No, hay que respetar porque no es
Oh, you did a pozo. My bad.
That was just a, you know, that was a brotherly, you know what I'm saying?
No, it looked like a damn, like I appreciate you kind of.
Yeah,
hug.
No.
Nothing crazy.
We kind of got, you know, we had a nice conversation, you know, and what she actually doing is incredible as well because she's truly involved into not just giving back, but using her platform to change a lot of, you know, social
injustices
and you know all that.
Yeah. So when you do go out, I see you in a lot of really big events.
Mm.
Like you are surrounded by a lot of really celeb debutante type
and
of people.
I hate doing that. Sometimes
I enjoy watching you.
Yeah. Like sometimes it's just me. Like it just I don't want to be braggadocious.
Nah, but I don't feel like you come across that way.
No,
like,
hell no.
You engage with those people. Like I think you was with Swiss and Alicia Keys, I think. No,
damn. That was the other. No,
you was with some power couple.
That was with another. That was another Felipe.
No, yeah, you talking about with like J Lo and A-Rod.
Eso
and,
era, damn.
And Cardi B and yeah.
But you look like you genuinely enjoy those people. It's not like
it's because you come across that the thing is that if you already have a relationship with that person,
yeah.
Then it's easy for you to come around. Like mm-hmm. you know the nonprofit that I had, I started it here.
Okay.
In the South Bronx.
Yep.
So through those connections, working in the South Bronx and Jennifer Lopez being from the South Bronx, we were chosen to represent part of an initiative that Jennifer Lopez had started in the South Bronx.
Oh.
So my kids were part of that. And then she came over to Orchard Beach and she threw a concert and we there.
You know what I'm saying? That's so cool.
And you know what I'm saying? It's kind of that and you know, A-Rod like having a connection to when he played not just with the Yankees but before that when he played in Texas where we used to like kind of come together and we used to like chill and we, you know, he used to come to the NBA games and,
right.
you know, so it's just a relationship that you already build with people that it's easy to kind of.
But you say, I don't really like to do that. But what I'm saying is the ones that I've looked at anyway, I don't feel like you're doing it for a bragging.
Yeah, you know, I'm not because sometimes like, okay, a celebrity, cool. You know,
right? But you're not
just I'm like, okay, like that's cool. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
I don't want to come across like every time I see a celebrity, oh, yo, let's take a picture.
Nah.
You know what I'm saying? Oh, let's go take a picture. You know, it's like,
no, right,
if it's
that,
cool, it's cool. If it's not,
right.
I'm good.
Yeah.
You know, like, we're good. Like, all right, you know, keep doing your thing.
Right.
You feel me?
Yeah. I'm like that too. I mean, I don't live in the same circle as you, but I'm not the type, and I mean, yo, if I saw Jay-Z, I don't know what I'd do. I love Swizz and Alicia Keys.
I've been to Jay-Z. I've been, you know, because I know OG.
OG. OG Mar, yeah,
oh,
yeah, yeah.
So
I've been to the offices and, you know, I'm there. It's myself, OG, and we're just having a conversation. Just, right. You know what I'm saying? Like, and we talking and I'm not like, yo, let's...
No, right. No, no, never,
feel
never,
like
it, never.
I feel like that just be a little bit like, okay, if we after... We can, like, all right, let's take a flick.
Yeah.
It's cool. But, like, just to be in the middle of something and be like, yo, let's take a picture.
No, but it takes away from the genuine nature of why you're there, right?
Exactly.
So, like, if I come across, for instance, if this wasn't the setup and I came across you in the street, my reaction, I probably wouldn't even say anything to you. Reason mm-hmm. being, not because I don't appreciate everything you've done, my heart would be going like this. And I know people like yourself, you probably get approached so often
yeah.
that to me, I'm like, yo, if I'm his shoes... I probably had it already. And I kind of want to take it. I want to be able to come outside.
Not me though. I'll be over there on Felipe.
No, but you know what? I take it differently. Like I take it that if you have taken the opportunity to say something to me,
yeah.
that's a sign of respect.
Yeah.
So I have to give some type of respect right back to you.
Okay.
You know, and show you that's important because you are important yourself.
Right.
Yes.
You know, so you giving me some kind of like.
Recognition.
Yeah. So I have to just be able to recognize that recognition that you're giving me, you know what I'm saying, by being genuine with you and having a conversation. Hey, yo, thank you, I appreciate it, support it, because I don't know how much you have supported me.
Right.
You
right.
might have supported me a little bit, you might supported me a lot.
A ton, right.
So it doesn't matter if you do a little or a lot, you're still part of, you know, the process in the growth in my career.
Yeah.
Let me, yo, which I love that you say that, man. You're so like to the, you're so about people. But I have a huge memory about you. When you were in St. John's, okay?
Mm-hmm.
You lit this city on fire.
It was dope,
you hear me, Sammy?
Yeah.
So we not letting you go. I love what you're doing. You're humanitarian. But we're going to talk a little basketball from St. John's perspective.
Can we go back just
more than that?
Just a year before he started at St. John's.
Right?
Yeah, because it still hurts me. I wasn't at St. Raymond at that time.
Oh,
I jumped in at the
fall.
Wait,
did y'all win the championship? Did you win?
Did he win the
championship? Against?
Kareem Reed and the St. Raymond Ravens.
That's not fair, bro.
You need to do a little bit of
that. I knew you were going to say that. Yo, I didn't think it was a
dollar. Yo, because you asked me a question.
Bleep that out.
Look, so.
But I wasn't asking you that question.
It still hurts me, but. Man, when I see some of and I hear the stories,
Dribble N Dimes, baby. We're in Dribble N Dimes.
When I hear what went down,
it was
Can you tell us? Walk us through
how
that
went
down.
It was first of all the rivalry.
Yeah.
It was crazy.
Yeah.
It made the city kind of like mobile and on the edge.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because of who they had, the players, the city, it was, you know, it was like that grind. You know what I'm saying? It was like the New York Knicks.
Yeah.
90s, you know, Charles
Oakley,
Mason,
and Pat, you know what I'm saying, and Allen Houston, and some, you know what I'm saying, John Starks.
Right.
That was the basketball that we enjoyed it. And, you know, just having those kind of battles in the city, it kind of kept the grind. Like,
it was on fire.
You feel me? And for me, it was great, man. It was almost like kind of, you know, every artist have a favorite place or favorite.
Like a lot of people say Madison Square Garden.
Yeah, like for me, like playing San Remo was my favorite.
Wow.
Yeah, it was my favorite because, you know, I have, you know, players there that we used to play with each other during the summer at Gauchos.
Okay.
Yeah.
You know, and they were honestly the best team. My freshman year, my sophomore year, I used to get my butt kicked by
San
Raymond's.
You can say ass.
You know, I used to get my butt kicked by San Raymond's, like plenty of time.
Yeah.
With Orlando Antigua, Terry Rancher, Damian Bonaparte, you know, the list goes on. Mm-hmm. Those guys, like, set it off for San Remy.
Right.
So by the time our junior year came and we started, you know, flipping things around, it was a sweet, nice feeling. You know what I'm saying? Now we got something going on. Like, you know, it's not the same, you know, ass whipping no more. Right. So it became that. It became, like, you know what I'm saying, a really true rival of love and hate. You know, we love them, but we hate them.
Are you still close to Kareem Reed?
Oh yeah, Remo. That's my cousin. We have had some. And it's funny because, you know, we New York City basketball, it goes beyond the court.
Definitely.
You know, it goes beyond the court. It goes more into like a family, brother kind of thing.
Yeah.
You know, and I was really appreciated that he came to the Dominican Republic. You know, he was able to spend some time in my country and see, you know, the craziness, why the craziness come from,
right,
and everything else like that. You know, I spent time with the family, you know, his grandma, I love his grandma and things like that. So, you know, it really had truly, you know, go beyond, you know what I'm saying, just the game.
Yeah. Yo, that is awesome. Okay.
And I'm truly happy for him, the fact that he went back to school, graduated.
Kareem Reed.
Yeah, he just graduated like 2 years ago. Yeah.
Wow.
He stayed there.
Shout out Kareem Reed.
Yeah, shout out to Kareem, man.
That's what's up, man. That's what's up.
He'll be on this show shortly.
Yes, yes. Lord willing. But now back to my question, okay? You set this city on fire, okay?
Fire.
When you was in St. John's, okay? I couldn't even meet up. We couldn't breathe without hearing St. John's and Felipe Lopez. Yeah. Big East was on fire. You were like the top of the line. I know we had a lot in the Big East. You said Ray Allen. We spoke about Kerry Kittles. And I'm not taking nothing away from them. But for us,
Iverson.
You were... right. Damn, I forgot about that too.
Yeah.
But...
don't forget, because they were competing heavy for High School Player of the Year.
Yeah.
But then he had the incident,
so
unfortunately.
That's
why it gave me the opportunity to become the Player of the Year. Not that I was not doing my thing.
Yeah.
But I never had the experience of playing AR in high school.
Right.
Oh,
you know, we never. And it was crazy because when we actually played our first game against each other, we knew who we are. Like, I know why he knows who I am. And he's playing for Georgetown, now I'm at St. John's. And you can tell from the minute the game, before the game started, that there was going to be, you know,
tension is
what I call, no, it's not tension. There was going to be a game within the game.
Oh, got it.
Yeah. And it was dope. I always love the competition, man.
For sure.
I was, you know, I like to test myself
right
with whoever was, you know, that guy. And what it became easy for me at an early was to not recognize anyone. In the sense that when I first got here, I wasn't able to speak the language.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So I'm just recognizing that I'm just playing basketball against I don't know who you are, as far as name. So the only thing that I'm kind of like seeing is if you're good or not.
Right.
You know, and the only way that I'm kind of feeling some kind of way, the only communicating part was when somebody would tap me in the back and be like, you know, like give you the
like
thumbs
you did
up.
A good job. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, because good job or great game was not, oh, okay.
Right.
So, oh, you know, so it became not an early thing, like not to really recognize who's in the court. Just show me what you got.
Mm.
You know? In a sense. And, you know, I kind of kept that, like, all through my career as far as, like, you know, just feeling like I was the dominant player on the court. You know, mm-hmm. I wanted to make sure that every game I would do something that when the people that came to watch the game, they left with, like,
oh, he's the man.
You saw what he did?
Right.
I enjoyed it.
That. You did that shit a lot.
Yeah, yes. And I enjoyed it. Like,
of course.
You know, big guys, especially at a high school level, you know, they still not to the full strength. And, you know, I was a kid that played basketball, tried baseball, but I used to run track as well.
Oh.
You know, so
I used to run. So your stamina was up there.
Yeah, it was crazy.
Wow, that explains
a lot. I would use my track training to take advantage of the basketball court as far as, like, being uptight on defense, getting steal, being on the fast break, running fast, pushing the ball,
mm-hmm.
you know, jumping high.
Mm-hmm.
So I mentioned the big guys because I always kind of made it, like I would kind of look at the opposite team and try to find out who was the big guy. And then I would make it to myself like, okay, Felipe, you're going to dunk on him.
Oh, shit.
So every time, if I would drive to the basket and I would see the guy, it gave me like a little bit boost, like doing out, trying out.
Yo, did you ever dunk it on Jaime Peterson?
Oh, plenty of time.
You know what? Right there. Jaime, we got some talking to do, Bobby. We got some explaining to do.
He knows that he might not be in the game, but practice or something.
Oh, you still get up?
No, not anymore. Yeah, no. After my surgery,
yeah,
after I tore my ACL, I lost a lot of I was capable of, and that was one of the main reasons I wasn't able to come back to the NBA and kind of play at my full potential.
Yeah,
and it just gave me a different opportunity, a different blessing. You know, God blessed me to allow me to travel.
Yeah.
And go to and visit other countries and play against some great international players. So,
right.
You know, the 5 years that I lasted in the NBA and then another six overseas in different country, I made it a point to go to a different country every year. Mm. I was not staying in one country. You know, I would just go play 1 year at different places. If I did well and they wanted to resign me, I'm like, you know, I just want to kind of go and try
different.
You know, what was your fondest memory of basketball? Like as you as a player, was it high school? Was it college? Was it NBA?
Was it Santiago?
Was it as a child? Like
my fondest memory?
Yeah,
is being called with the number 24 pick in the NBA.
Yeah,
I think that was
San Antonio.
That was almost like a. A true dream, something of a dream.
Were you at home?
Yeah, I was home.
I saw the footage.
Yeah.
I remember that.
Yeah. I watched that draft for sure.
Yeah, I was at home. I was home with the.
Did you have the Platano phone? There was something going down in your house. Some Platano shit. No,
I remember that. Matter of fact, I think ESPN was in your house.
I think it was MSG.
Okay. Right. I remember seeing your family or whoever sitting next to you.
Yeah.
How did you feel about being drafted number 24? Did you expect to be
earlier? No, not at all. Like with the NBA, everything you don't know.
Right.
You don't know, I did everything possible, in college to kind of be successful with the team. And unfortunately, it wasn't like that. Made it to the NCAA my last year. Finished with some great numbers at St. John's. I finished three all-time in scoring, number one with the most three-pointers and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
But, that was not enough to guarantee you a spot in the NBA. So when I was able to go and try out for 17 different teams.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, in a period of three weeks.
Jesus wow. Christ.
That was fun. That was actually fun.
Really?
But anyway, yeah, it was fun because the competition came back.
Oh, okay.
For me, it was about the competition. So, I was competing against the best players from Duke, from Arizona, Kentucky. But now it was different because, they don't have a coach. There's not a system. And I knew that I was really good one-on-one player and I was a good defender. So it's now you against me. Nobody's
telling you anything. Yeah.
Yeah, so I was a beast on that.
That's cool.
So taking it back real fast, I know we're jumping around, but
mm-hmm.
McDonald's All-American game, you left there with the MVP.
Yeah.
And you were playing against some, I can't remember who it was exactly. There was a bunch of like big-time NBA players that came out of that.
Yeah. Kareem was playing there. Kareem, Zander Hamilton was there.
Wow. Yeah, I forgot about Zander Hamilton. Oof.
I'm trying to think who they expected to take like the MVP, but then you like came out of nowhere just.
That was a great time. It was an awesome time.
Damn, man.
For me, especially we playing in the city too, man. We played it at St. John's, and I was excited. I knew a lot of those guys were coming into the city. Some of them were coming into the city for the first time.
Yeah.
So I have an edge up that I'm from the city, and I have 3,000 platanos in the state.
Yeah, that's intimidating as hell.
For some of them, it was because they never, what's intimidating? Anybody that's not from the city and you say, like, yo, we go to Queens or we go to the Bronx or we go to Brooklyn, the first thing they say, am I going to be okay?
Especially you being from the South Bronx here, like let's go to the South Bronx.
Nah, honestly, I had some people come from when I used to play it in Vancouver.
Yeah,
they came to visit the city, and you know, there's a pretty nice spots in the Bronx.
Yeah,
not you know,
Riverdale.
So I was like, we're gonna go to the Bronx, and you're like, where?
Can we not do that?
Can we go somewhere else? Like, nah, you're all right. You're good. You're gonna be with me.
You're gonna be with me.
But you know, like it just that you don't just feel like bullets is gonna be like flying and just catching.
And they don't want to tell you nothing, but you know what it is.
No, eventually we never made it to the Bronx.
Let's just stay down here. Downtown is fine. Yeah. This is close enough.
So it was cool for the Madonna All-American game because John Wooden. He was a great coach at UCLA.
Yes.
I had a great opportunity. He was the one that presented me with the trophy.
Oh,
wow. You know, the game was a great game. You know, I think I remember like 25 points or something like that.
Yeah, that's crazy.
We won. Awesome time, man. I was on the top of the world, man. Honestly, I was on the top of the world. After that, I went to Detroit and I played the Magic All-Star game. And I got the MVP there as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm like, everywhere I was rolling, man, my self-esteem was at a different level.
I have a question. I know I'm going to jump around again myself. And this is something that stuck with me. Again, like where I followed you basically from college on. And when we all saw you land in the NBA, we were all proud. And my question is, when you got injured in the NBA, when you were in Vancouver, initially when you first got injured, what was your psyche like? What was your mindset like?
Man. It's hard. I never had an injury like that. To me, I'm like, my world have crashed.
Right.
You know, I'm thinking like, this is it. I'm done. This is what everybody talks about when you have an injury. Like, dude, like, ain't no way I'm going to recover from this.
Right.
You know, at that moment.
Mm-hmm.
But God always works in mysterious ways, man. And, you know, he has different playing for people that sometimes you just got to trust what he's doing in your life. And, you know, for me, I've been blessed, man. I was at home yesterday, and I'm like, man, you know, with all and all, I truly been blessed with so many things in my life that I can't regardless, you know. I never been hungry. You know, I've been able to do the things that I love. I've been able to help. He truly gave me a humble heart, you know what I'm saying? So it's just like, what else do you need, you know what I mean?
No. Yeah. I think you're a prime example, man. You have a question now.
Yeah, so when you came, what prompted you guys to leave DR and come to New York?
My grandma, from my father's side, she was already living here. And as Dominican family, we all come for a better
life.
Living. Mm-hmm.
So you guys had the opportunity to make it through with the visa process and all that.
Yeah, it took time.
Sure.
My mother and one of my brothers came first, and my father came in 1983.
Okay.
Then 3 years later, when my father got here, he put the papers for the whole family. They weren't allowed to, you know, bring the whole family. So my brother and my mother and my brother came in 86, then my sister and I came in 89,
okay.
And then my oldest brother came in 92.
Damn. But now everybody's here.
Yeah, everybody's here. Yeah, okay. Everybody's here.
So what does Felipe do now? Like, what are all the things that you're involved in?
What are all the things? Well, I've been, like I mentioned before, I probably have served the NBA as an NBA KS ambassador for the past 10 years. Just working on different programs that the NBA have provided me to be part of, and I'm grateful for that. I was part of the mentoring program that Barack Obama has started, my brother's keeper.
Okay,
allowed me to, you know, go to the White House 3 times. I met with them. I played basketball with the former president.
Nice.
Wow. You got footage? You got to have some footage for yourself.
I got pictures.
Yeah.
I got all that. So, you know, we're working on a reform right now where we're actually going into Rikers Islands.
Mm.
And we're working with the juvenile to make sure that they not just go to school there, but they are able to have a platform that once they come out, that they can continue. Because what happens is the cycle, it goes right back where they come into the hood and they just end up in the same situation that they were before they, you know.
Yeah, before they went in.
Yeah.
That's right.
So we're working with other organizations. Very institutional, and there's a few of them that are helping us to make sure that they maintain the status of going to school and keeping himself busy.
Okay. That's awesome.
You know, that's through the NBA, through, you know, personal, I still have my Ministerio de Fe, nonprofit in Santo Domingo, running the club, which, you know, at this time it's a little bit hard because now we have the semi-pro, so I had to put a really pro team together and then pay the guys, so, you know, looking for sponsor money, so I'm like the GM and the owner.
Wow.
You know, so
wearing all the hats.
Yeah, wearing all the hats, and but it's fun. You know, yeah. It's gonna be a 2-year process. I already worked there for 1 year. I have one more year. I'm very proud of the work that the whole administration have been able to do, the changes that we have been able to do. You know, just bringing again like that feeling of hope, that feeling of, you know, we have, you know, a club that truly care for the youth, not just for the educational piece, but we. We're bringing, I truly believe education is being the key for anything. Mm-hmm. You know, I wouldn't be able to be sitting here if I didn't graduate from St. John's.
Yeah.
Right.
So I truly appreciate that, even though I made it a hard way to get to the NBA, but it was the best way for me because it have kept me where I'm at.
Yeah. Right.
You know, it was just not about basketball. If I would have gone a different route, there was no way that I would looked up in a different light because the education is the key.
Yeah.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Being able to see and a room of just, you know, professionals. And, you know, for them to take your point in a serious kind of note is because you know how to move. Properly behave, move, make your opinion, and see things, you know what I'm saying, in a different light. And basketball is not just going to provide that.
That's right.
By itself.
Well,
you know,
I just want to say, just based on that, when you talked about yourself at 11 years old, running laps, okay, without that coach there, I mean, it's no wonder... There's no wonder who you are today, so I just wanted to throw that in.
So I have a final question for you.
Go ahead.
Are there any regrets?
Oof. Are any regrets?
Do you have
any? No, you run through things on your head that, oh man, I should have done this differently and things like that. But honestly, at the end of the day, you can't live with regrets because, you know, you always, that if is what's going to get you.
Mm-hmm.
That if is what's going to get your hair a little bit greater and things right. like that. You know what I'm saying? So, like I mentioned earlier, man, you gotta allow, you know, the Lord to like continue working in your process and to give you, you know, saying the wisdom and understanding that it might not be your will, but He's working. He's working on the process. You know what right. I'm saying? And I would say that, you know, everybody has ambitions, and different. There's different ways to success.
Yeah.
You know. There's tons of different ways of success. Sometimes we might look at a janitor that had worked for 25 years out of school as like, man, I would never want to be that. But you know what? That man has been successful raising a family through that
right.
job.
Yeah.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So you cannot like, judge you know, him. Undermine somebody for what they're doing because they're actually making it better for you.
Right.
And, you know, I would feel like that when I play, you know, in the league. I say hi to everybody. I want to know what everybody's doing because that's at right. the end of the day, okay, I'm a player, but just... You, the person that is carrying the stacks to somebody else to see it, you are making it better.
Right.
You are
right.
providing information, providing a better service to somebody. So I appreciate that.
Yeah.
That's right. Like, that's cool. Like, you know, it's funny because at St. John's, one of my best friends that I learned a lot was a manager.
Really?
You know, he's a manager. Yeah, he was a manager on the team. And today he's one of the greatest being, you know, CEO of a company.
Wow.
That, you know, if I would have seen it in a totally different light, today he would have been like, ah, nah, Felipe was an asshole.
Right.
Well, that's my dude.
Right.
That's and I love that because he told me so many, you know, he told me a great, deal you know, things. We was talking about IPA. Right. He told me about IPA.
Right.
He told me about Pearl Jam. I like Pearl Jam. They, right. they you know, they rock.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, so it's like allowing yourself to learn from the perspective of all the successful people. And that's what I've been able to captivate through my experience, to my travel. Just always be open.
Open to learning.
Yeah. To learning, to opinion.
And being just a basic human being, bro.
Of course, man. Yeah. So that's, man, that's, you know what I'm saying? That's like something that I truly have enjoyed through this whole thing that it's not just the basketball. The basketball introduced me to it. I just have... Find a way to make it better and bigger.
I have one last question as well. I want to ask you, what is it that your role is with NBA Cares? Like, what would you say you do exactly? I'm just curious as to, like, what that is. What does it
take? So, So as an ambassador, you pretty much represent the NBA.
Right.
You represent them in a different topics that could be. And we're the social responsible department.
Yeah. Okay.
You know, so we can go from, you know, for example, mm-hmm. we know that there's a lot of issues with cops mm-hmm. in communities. Mm-hmm. So we open the window, the platform to create, you know, a dialogue between communities and cops. Mm-hmm. You know, so we are there, you know, trying to help, you know, solve a better relationship with the communities. Our players, they become very outspoken. We have a platform which is called NBA Voice, that the players are very outspoken about social justice or issues that they feel important to them. And LeBron does a great job of that.
Sure. Yes.
You see what I'm saying?
Yes.
Like, you know, the league supports, you know, we have the WNBA. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we support equality.
Yes.
Right. You know, and it's just kind of hitting on some of those issues that some other, you know, sports, they have not been able to get into. But for us, it's important because it's part of just the game.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So that's in the sense, that's what I do. I'm in the front, you know, on different topics, different issues, whatever it is that, you know what I'm saying, that we can do the job through the image and the platform that the NBA can provide.
I just want to say, man, thank you so much. I know every listener in here.
We got to do a part two, man.
Yes, we are. Yes. Yes.
Oh, you thought this was a one and done?
Yeah.
We don't do
that.
Yeah. We don't do that.
Yeah,
no, and then next time, you know what? We're actually going to be organizing on time.
We're going to have a little brugada here, too.
No, yeah, we do a brugada, and, you know, yeah, we do a part two, man. And
for sure.
Thank you.
Because, obviously, you know, I thank you guys for giving me the opportunity.
Thank you, man.
To you know, honestly, I listen to you guys, man, so this is a kick for me as well.
Let me say, man, I love that shirt, by the way. A lot of my Rice buddies are going to love that shirt. So we got to take a picture of you that shirt so we can represent you.
For sure. Let's do it.
Thank you, brother. I appreciate you. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you for listening to this episode of Dribble N Dimes. If you like what you heard, please leave a review or comment wherever you're listening to us now. Check us out on social media as well. We're live on Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube. On all platforms, you can find us at DribbleNDimes.